Welcome to this edition of Excavating the Bible, What Archaeology Can Teach Us. This program is dedicated to exploring the contributions that archaeologists who work in the Middle East have given to our understanding of and appreciation for the Bible. I'm Doug Clark. I direct the Center for Near Eastern Archaeology at La Sierra University. I'm joined by two long-standing members of these episodes walking our way through the Bible and archaeology. Dr. Larry Geraty, co-host of the program, and also an associate director of the center at La Sierra, and Kent Bramlett, also an associate director and professor in archaeology and the history of antiquity at La Sierra. We are now thinking about a different kind of book. We've been working for some time now with the prophets as we've gone through the Bible and archaeology book by book. So we turn now to the book of Lamentations. Probably not everyone's favorite, devotional reading. It's probably not a place that people have their Bibles sort of automatically open to when they're looking for a boost. So what about this book of Lamentations? Let's just think about it for a minute before we look at possible connections with archaeology.
Wow, it is a pretty heavy book. But it really expresses, I think, the absolute sorrow and lostness, the feeling of, you know, what's next? Where are we with God? And yet, being able to express those feelings, I think, also teaches us something, that we can show our feelings to God.
That raises a question. Somebody told me once that, according to at least some of the rabbis, it's okay to disagree with God, it's okay to shout at God, and we have shouting at God. Mm-hmm. In Lamentations. Mm-hmm. It's okay to argue with him. You just can't deny God. Mm-hmm. And maybe this should give us a bit of freedom to express ourselves. There's a kind of a sense in which we really don't want to say the bad things. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if that's out of fear or respect. But I think you're right, Kent, that maybe this is permission to tell God what we think. And to do so from the depths of our heart, especially now out of a very painful situation.
Presumably it's written after the destruction of Jerusalem, and the lament is over the loss of the city and of the land and of everything that Israel had hoped for. It would sort of be comparable maybe to our situation in the United States with the 9/11 catastrophe and New York being destroyed. What a shock that was. And various poets and historians, the kinds of things that they wrote after that would be the same genre as what we're looking at tonight.
And these were used in worship. In fact, annually, these are publicly read. Mm-hmm. So
we usually think of Tish B'Av, that would be
the ninth of Av,
the Jewish month Av. And even in today's Jewish circles, this book, Lamentations, is recited and used on an annual basis.
It reminds me of a movie. I'm not sure how many people saw it. It was on TV. Mm-hmm. This must have been in the 80s. I don't remember exactly when. And it was called The Day After. Mm. And it was a film about an atomic bomb that goes off somewhere in the Midwest. And all of the chaos that mm-hmm. creates. Mm-hmm. But toward the end of the film, in the midst of this charred rubble and radioactivity too, I'm not sure how they put all of that together, in the middle of all of this rubble and smoke still rising, people had gathered around the ruins of a church and were singing hymns. And I'm thinking, that sounds a lot like Lamentations, where you are still believe, but you have huge questions. And you come to the place of worship to express them. So these weren't just out there, and these weren't just written down by somebody. These were written down for and by a community in dire straits.
What are your theories about who was involved? Is this Jeremiah? Does he have anything to do with this book?
Yeah, I can give you my response to that. I'm going to watch Kent, too, to see what he's going to do with this one. There's, I think, a lot of reason to think that Jeremiah has something to do with that. Mm-hmm. I mean, the sort of heart pathos that is expressed in them, the sense that of speaking openly to God, Jeremiah does that throughout his book. Mm-hmm. And it's brutal. I mean, it's just absolutely brutal the way Jeremiah talks to God. Mm-hmm. So possibly so, but I'm not sure that it's all his work. Mm-hmm. These are specific, well-designed laments. We have laments in the Book of Psalms. Mm-hmm. Actually have half of the Book of Psalms are mm-hmm. lament types of psalms. Mm-hmm. So this is a fairly standard style, literary style, a worship style. And I'm not sure that he would be the one to have written them. But it seems to me he could certainly be influential. I don't know. What do you think?
I haven't worked with Lamentations that deeply. But I mean, the voice, to me, carries on with the resonance of Jeremiah.
Right.
But I'm sure it would resonate and express the words of all the community.
There's something in this book that you don't know when you read it in English, that if you read it in Hebrew, immediately becomes obvious, doesn't it? The kind of poetry, and we call it an acrostic. Talk a little bit about that and how different that is.
Kent, you're teaching the Hebrew now. Sure. If you want to talk about acrostic, I'll just tuck in a footnote or two.
Many of these things were memorized. And you need sort of systems to remember, right? Mm-hmm. So the acrostic uses, there are different kinds, but the acrostic method starts a line, or it could even be more, two lines, but each, like doublets, mm-hmm. With the succeeding letters of the Hebrew alphabet. So the beginning you have words, the line that begins with Aleph, and mm-hmm. Beit, and Gimel, and so forth. And you proceed through. So of course you have to pick your words accordingly, but we do it in rhyming poetry as well. We have to pick our words. So it's a form of poetry, but it was also useful for memorization.
That might explain why when people read the chapters mm-hmm. of Lamentations, that the verse numbers are always a multiple of 22, because mm-hmm. there's that many letters in the Hebrew alphabet.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Chapter 3 has 66, because it's triplicate. Mm-hmm. And then if you go to Psalm 119, there are 8 lines that begin with Aleph, 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 mm-hmm. and then 8 with Beit, Beit. I think you lose the memory device when you have that many.
Right.
But in any case, that device. Mm-hmm. So somebody had to be pretty clever to put this into that format.
Yeah, yeah. And in Lamentations, I think it's usually 3, right? So Aleph is the letter that they begin with, but the next 3 lines all are Aleph, and then the next 3 are Beit
in the third chapter.
Right, yeah.
Where you have the 66 mm-hmm, verses. Mm-hmm, so. Mm-hmm. Well, before we go more into the book, let's look at some artifacts. Mm-hmm. Artifacts from this time period, and we actually begin to bleed more into the 6th century. Mm-hmm. When we're talking about Lamentations, because this is after the fall,
right.
And probably not long after the fall mm-hmm. of Jerusalem in 587, 86. And it is these artifacts that will move us toward another prophet, the prophet Ezekiel. Mm-hmm. Kent, tell us what you have in front of you.
Well, we have our Nebuchadnezzar brick. This is one of several million that Nebuchadnezzar's workmen stamped with the message from Nebuchadnezzar, saying, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, the restorer of the temple of Esagila and Ezida, the rightful or noble son of Nabopolassar, king of Babylon. Of course, it's written in the old cuneiform signs. It's not even the later neo-contemporary signs, but sort of classic, it's sort of archaizing. And it's written in very formal Akkadian, even though everybody's speaking Aramaic by this time, even the king's household. And so you have signs that go back to Sumerian. The word for king is Lugal, and they use this old Sumerian sign, but they probably read it as Shar, which was the Babylonian version.
Term,
right.
And then you have another tablet.
Another tablet, right. It was a very literate part of the world. We have a lot of records that come out of Mesopotamia, and we can only wish that areas where we excavate had as many archives as...
You have your antenna up, Kent, to find the library.
Yes, so.
We're depending on you.
Tell them what about that tablet speaks of Mesopotamia, where it was made. Why did it take the shape and form and so on that it did?
These?
Yeah.
The small ones? Well, these are, I mean, they're rounded a little bit because they use a stylus, mm-hmm. an angled reed, and you can make clearer signs. Actually, my students discovered this. I have them, at the end of the quarter of studying Akkadian, make a tablet and put Nebuchadnezzar's inscription on it.
Uh-huh.
And some of them made flat ones, and they were very difficult to write on. So if you make it a little bit like a loaf, uh-huh. rounded, uh-huh. you get a much clearer impression as you work along. And you could actually put these in an envelope of clay mm-hmm. that would seal them. You could bake them and send them, and then you know if they've been tampered with. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You have, if you receive one that's still sealed in its original clay envelope, you break it to get into the inside.
And we have evidence of those envelopes, don't we?
We do.
And sometimes tablets within.
Yeah, we find them sometimes intact.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Well, we move from cuneiform and Mesopotamia down to Egypt, where alabaster is used a lot. And these are mace heads made from alabaster. So this is something that a pharaoh would hold up, or some important person, as a mace, a sign of authority and power. And of course, ones that weren't in alabaster, just a plain old stone, would be used in warfare. And these rounded stones, also chert, are used in battle. And they're very effective when they are thrown by a siege machine or by some automatic thrower that would wreak a lot of damage. And then these are metal, all bronze right here, that belong to swords and spears and awls and various kinds of implements. Even an axe head and some small arrowheads that flew through the air and met their target.
And we put these here in part because really all of the books from this time period
right.
talk about warfare.
Right.
But Lamentations in particular, I can almost, I mean, in a way, you almost have to have these in front of you mm-hmm. to capture the pain, the deep pain and pathos of the Book of Lamentations.
Mm-hmm.
What we have on this side of the table, this jar doesn't come from the time period, but it does demonstrate something that was smashed because of a destruction and part of it burned. Mm-hmm. And so in putting it back together, we find out which parts were burned and which were not, but it certainly illustrates life and death mm-hmm. and a destruction. And then broken pieces of pottery, a lot of the biblical writers utilize this metaphor mm-hmm. to talk about destruction of soul mm-hmm. and a sense of despair.
Mm-hmm.
So then let's take a look at the Book of Lamentations itself and of the outline. Larry, you're a good outline person here. Tell us what this is
well, about. Well, here we've got five chapters in the Book of Lamentations, and so each chapter sort of can be a unit to itself. And the first chapter being Jerusalem, the widow calls upon God for pity. The second, the people cry to God to show mercy. The third, Judah mourns her fate. The fourth, the poet laments the siege and the sack of Jerusalem. And finally, the fifth, the people pray for the restoration of Zion. Great hope that one day it'll be restored.
Another thing we might want to say about Lamentations, that is mm-hmm. laments, mm-hmm. As a hymn structure, as a mm-hmm. type, is that the meter in the lament itself is a downer.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You go from a beat that's high and it drops at the end. It's mm-hmm. it's intentionally that way mm-hmm. because mm-hmm. it is a downer.
Right.
It turns out that most of the laments in the Book of Psalms actually end with something of an upswing. Mm-hmm. Something of a positive note, something of, but God, you've watched us through all of this despair. Is there still something we can look to you for? Mm-hmm. Is there some reason we can trust you? Mm-hmm. But not in the Book of Lamentations. Mm-hmm. You almost get it at the end. There's just a whiff of possibility, but the very last verse takes us back to the gloom.
Mm-hmm.
But in chapter 3, verse 21, you do have that yet. I remember reading through that and being amazed. Yet. And it's something like, I remember this, and we'll have hope. So there's that little bit of not giving up completely.
And maybe that's the only reason these texts really end up in the Bible. Mm-hmm. You know, that may have been a misstatement. I wanted to say that because of the hope. I mean, hope is so much a part mm-hmm. of biblical religion, mm-hmm. Hebrew thought. There's a lot of hope built into that. Mm-hmm. And so that would certainly help. But at the same time, Hebrew faith is really honest, mm-hmm. is mm-hmm. truly honest mm-hmm. and transparent. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, we've got that complexity. Thank you for spotting that. You do have to look carefully in the Book of Lamentations to find those, but they are there. A map that tells us something about the whole of the Babylonian Empire. Think about the taking of Jerusalem, 587, 586, and taking the exiles, not huge numbers. I mean, in the single-digit thousands, we're talking about.
And the red dotted line would indicate the route that they probably took as they left Judah, had to go north along the coast, and then crossing over to the Euphrates, and then coming down to Babylon.
Right. And it may be that with this map here, might be a good place to start what we're going to talk about on the next slide, and that is the dilemmas of the exile. Mm-hmm. This is about 600 to 700 miles, mm-hmm. walking, of course, and there are a number of passages in the Hebrew Bible that talk about being hooked, with being led into captivity. Not necessarily this one, but as a way of talking about the way people are treated, mm-hmm. with hooks. Sometimes in their noses mm-hmm. being drawn, sometimes with nets mm-hmm. being drawn and corralled toward captivity. So if we talk about the dilemmas of the exile, that first mm-hmm. one would be the very physical dimensions mm-hmm. of disaster and death. Mm-hmm. And then let's look at a list of them. Let me say something about these, and I'll just list them off, and then let's talk about them mm-hmm. and see. So the temple is gone. The Bible is very clear about that. Archaeology is very clear about that. The priesthood then doesn't have a place to work. The land has been taken over by foreigners. The covenant is over between God and Moses and the people at Sinai. There's no Davidic king on the throne. He's in chains, actually two of them now in chains mm-hmm. in Babylon. Foreigners have taken over. The losses due to warfare that we talked about, and with that, this sense that theology doesn't make any sense either.
We know that you've made a special study of these elements from the book of Ezekiel, which certainly applies here because it's talking about the same period. What's the impact or import of this list?
You know, in Ezekiel, and we will be coming to Ezekiel, thank you. It's a great book. Again, not on everybody's favorite devotional reading list, but it's a great book. With Ezekiel, this list of dilemmas, the loss of this, the loss of that, actually find, as Ezekiel, in the first part of Ezekiel, these oracles against Judah, then the oracles against the nations, this transition to hope, mm-hmm. and then unadulterated hope. Mm-hmm. That's what you have toward the end. And what you end up having in Ezekiel is a resolution to all of these elements of loss. That's why this has been so important mm-hmm. to me mm-hmm. in the book of Ezekiel. So when one considers not just the whole, but each of these parts, one could not imagine that the temple would be destroyed, ever. Remember mm-hmm. the temple sermon Jeremiah?
Right.
One could never imagine that. What am I going to do for forgiveness now? There's no temple. There's no place to offer the sacrifice. Mm-hmm. We think about it. It's a, you know, it's a historical note. Shows mm-hmm. up in some of those books we don't pay a lot of attention to in the Bible. But this was absolutely essential. This is essential if mm-hmm. we want to understand the depths mm-hmm. of the Babylonian exile. Mm-hmm. And this teaches me, and it did when I first did this work on Ezekiel, that the depth of the Babylonian exile, not only, I think it did two things. A total upheaval of everything held dear, mm-hmm. life, but theology too. Mm-hmm. If history doesn't make sense, one of the commentators says, then theology doesn't make sense. So why would you worship this God who just wiped out mm-hmm. his own house, Andrew. I mean, why would you do that? Mm-hmm. And there's no way to connect with him. The, mm-hmm. the priests are no longer functioning. Mm-hmm. The covenant says, if you violate the covenant, you're going to lose the land. Well, the land's gone now. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Foreigners have taken over. All of these things led to this incredibly deep pit into which Judah had fallen. Mm-hmm. And how to get out of that is the question. Jeremiah actually starts. Mm-hmm. In fact, at the very end of Jeremiah, that little passage about, and we've looked at it with Jeremiah, that Jehoiakim mm-hmm. in 561, 62 receives extra rations. He's brought up to eat with the king in mm-hmm. his quarters. That's a little bit of hope that maybe something good is going to come out mm-hmm. of this. Mm-hmm. But the other thing about these dilemmas is that they set the stage for God and prophets to do something, well, another biblical writer, to do mm-hmm. something majestic. Mm-hmm. A number of scholars have said that the best literature, including the hope parts, mm-hmm. the best hope literature comes out of the crucible mm-hmm. of the exile. Mm-hmm. So, okay, so you've got the greatest disaster, but in many ways, out of that comes some of the best literature.
That's a very helpful thing to remember in our own time when we have disappointments, whether the personal or national, that there can be hope. Right. And you can come out of that stronger and better if you relate right. to your catastrophe in that kind of a way. Yeah.
Even if the snippet of hope, as Kent noted mm-hmm. in Lamentations, we have it full-blown in other materials, including mm-hmm. another section that we'll be coming to in Isaiah, mm-hmm. chapters 40 and following, which is totally unbridled celebrating of right. of hope mm-hmm. and good news. Mm-hmm. So out of these hard times, mm-hmm. out of these dilemmas, can grow mm-hmm. really impressive things. So we have some archaeological issues to think about. Destruction layers. Are destruction layers good news or bad news for archaeologists?
We look forward to finding them.
Since they happened, we may as well.
Oh, okay. Right. We wouldn't want to have been there.
Because they're markers for between what comes before and what comes after. You know, it produces a kind of a layer that gives you confidence that you know how to date it.
Right. And the debris often seals in
right.
layer.
Right.
It's later they dug down that deep, which
right.
rarely happens. Doesn't always happen.
Yeah.
The human side of death and devastation, we'll see actually a slide to illustrate that from one of our colleagues mm-hmm. excavating nearby in Jordan. And then, although we don't have any, I don't have any slides of siege and famine remains, we could look at some of the skeletal remains mm-hmm. and find mm-hmm. evidences.
We have those in reliefs, don't we, on right. walls where kings record those sieges and famines and so
right,
on.
Right, right. Kent, I think you did. I think you had something to do with this slide.
Yeah, my first excavation was in this house. Well, this is actually one of our subsequent houses.
But it's very much like it.
It's part of the same village, right. yes. So I was a field director at that point. The burned bricks that you see are actually the upper walls of somebody's house. Mm-hmm. And as the beams burned, you can see the charcoal layers. Those are roof beams. As they burned, they actually fired the brick and preserve it. You can see the mortar lines between the individual bricks right, as right. they toppled over. But again, this sealed in, like a time capsule, everything that was, that didn't burn and that wasn't looted out first.
Right, right. A number of metaphors used in Lamentations. Mm-hmm. What do we see here, Larry?
Well, talks about suffering under an oxen's yoke. And at times we've had here on our table something to illustrate that. Being trodden down as in a wine press, and we've excavated many wine presses. Being shot by arrows,
divine.
In this case.
Identified as divine, by the writer.
Right. Being forced to grind one's teeth on gravel. You'd be pretty hard up if you were chewing on gravel, but that's what happens after a catastrophe like we're talking about. Being crushed underfoot like a prisoner, and being flung into a pit with stones. All of those metaphors are grow out of familiarity with what was going on in the Middle East.
Even if the plural of oxen doesn't fit the singular article in front of it. Okay, so an ox's yoke, that's going to be my fault. We've looked at these before from Egypt, Kent.
Yeah, it's the wonderful illustrations of everyday life. So here are, well, a yoke of oxen. I think we can use the plural or the dual here.
Yes.
And pulling the plow. This is what it was like. Do you imagine yourself in that yoke? That's how it felt.
And then some other implements, including the plow and what you would put around the necks of the animals. Again, oppressing them with despair in this case. And then we have some other metaphors, a wine press like this one, in which people would stand, I guess, on the left side, Kent, is that right?
Yep.
And squeeze the grape juice and it would drain into the reservoir on the right-hand side. An illustration out of
Reader's Digest. Looks like a happy scene, doesn't it?
You know, it is. I mean, they have survived through another year of bugs and beasts and all kinds of threats to their agricultural well-being. So, yes, they are happy. In fact, they seem to be blowing the double flutes and so on, two double pipes.
And, of course, Lamentations means that's all in the past. We can't do that anymore.
That's right. Now here's a depiction of rulers, Assyrians in this case, standing over, tromping down. We saw that as one of the metaphors. And then another one is this one. Do either of you remember where this picture comes from?
It's from the Matapa Plains projects, which we work together with Andrews University and other institutions, a site called Jalul.
Tell
nearby.
In a well, wasn't it? A cistern.
Some kind of cistern. From about this time period, maybe a little earlier, I don't remember the exact date, the floor had a hole right in the middle, which opened to this cistern or storage chamber or whatever. And then when this place was conquered, people, skeletons,
dumped down in,
stones, all of this thrown in at the same time. We assume they were dead at the time, but it captures very well what Lamentations talks about and the disaster, the sense of despair that grows out of this kind of disrespect for even for burying the bones. So we do have evidence. Can't we have some, I think, at La Sierra in part of our collections of skulls with trauma evidence?
We do. Head trauma that was not survived.
Right.
Actually, from the same village where we saw the burned bricks a little bit ago.
Correct, correct. And then we do have some laments from Ur. We won't have time to look at those this time. We've actually looked at them before. But they're so much like the Book of Lamentations in that they address their concerns to the god or the gods and wonder why these things happen to them. So we've got these parallels from the ancient world, which connects even with a small book like Lamentations and even with the kinds of concerns that, that it carries. Thank you, Larry. Thank you, Kent. And thank all of you for joining us for this edition of Excavating the Bible. We hope the program has given you something to think about, something to add to your faith journey, and we do look forward until next time. Until then, think ancient, keep believing, and keep exploring. For Excavating the Bible, I'm Doug Clark.